Welcome to Uncontained, episode 120. I'm your host, Aaron Static Render, and before we kick off the show, I would just like to take a moment of silence to thank the servicemen and women who have fallen protecting this country and making it possible for us to do things like this podcast and so many more things that we take for granted. So thank you for your sacrifice. Now, I do have a really good show for you. I speak to a two-piece rock band called Ascent, made up of Christina and Bruce Baldwin. Christina does the vocals, and Bruce, he makes all the other sound on stage, kind of the composer of the group. And with the two of them, they make it all happen live without a pre-recorded backing track or hiring another band. You'll have to listen to find out how Bruce and Christina make stadium-sized noise with a bar-sized band. So definitely check that out. And before I jump into the show, they were cool enough to hook me up with a brand new track of theirs. It's called Beacon 11. So I'm just going to jump into the show. Lots of show coming your way with Bruce and Christina Baldwin and the band Ascent.
In the deepest, blackest ocean, I drift for hours, no direction known. Shines a beacon, a light upon me, a kind of violin, a simple sign of life. Am I
Ascent, Christina and Bruce Baldwin. Welcome to Uncontained, and how are you guys doing today?
Awesome. Thank you. We're excited to be here.
Awesome. Great. Thank you for coming on. And well, we'll just get to it. You guys are a two-piece band, female fronted, and you guys go out and play live. How do you do that? Do you hire a band to come out and play with you, or is there a Trent Reznor in the band?
Well, I don't know if I'm Trent Reznor per se, but I actually play a lot of different instruments, you know, guitar and drums and bass and keyboards and pretty much anything that anybody leaves lying around for long enough, I learned to play at some point. So when we play live, I use looping to be able to play drums, an electronic drum and samples and stuff and loop it, you know, that keeps playing. I play some rhythm guitar, loop it, that keeps playing. I play some bass lines, etc. I've got different sounds that I trigger from all different places with my feet and with little pads that I have. It's all live. We hate pre-recorded stuff. We'll never do that. It's all done with looping of a massive pedal board that I use and trigger all this stuff to play. So that's kind of how we do it. It sounds like, people will say it sounds like a full band, and that's what we're striving for. We want it to sound like rock.
Absolutely. And I just sing.
Not saying that's the easy job, but at least you have one thing to concentrate on, and that's
right.
And you do it well, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, so first of all, how did you guys form as a band?
So the story goes, a long, long time ago.
We won't even say how long.
We're not going to say how long.
We don't need dates. You can even change names if you want.
A while back, I was a karaoke singer begging for somebody to, quote, discover me. And had a whole bunch of friends, and we would always go and we would do karaoke. And then one day, I thought, wait a minute. No one's ever going to discover me in a karaoke bar singing somebody else's songs. I want to be part of a band. So I looked for ads for singers. I mean, I'm just saying the level of balls that it took to do that, what I'd never done, that was crazy, but I did it. I found an ad that seemed to make sense. I called the number, ended up talking to this guy for about an hour, went and auditioned, and what, 2.5 weeks later, I was in the band. And we were a big five-piece prog rock band called Immersed at that time. That's how it started.
And one by one, people kind of dropped out or were fired. It ended up just being us, and it turned out to be the easiest and the best thing. We tried to do the acoustic thing for a long time because it was the only thing that we really could do to play live, was me playing acoustic guitar and her singing. But we were recording songs with, you know, drums and bass and electric guitars, you know, and I played all that stuff. So we kind of slowly, you know, once I realized there was a way to do all this stuff live, kind of turned back into a full band, but just the two of us.
Okay, cool, cool. So Christina, like you said, you were doing karaoke and everything, hoping to be discovered. What is it that changed your mindset from trying to be like the karaoke superstar to going out and deciding to create and join a band?
I think that there was this lofty idea in my mind that I could change people's lives with the thoughts and experiences that I had. I'd always been a poet, so I'd always been writing poetry, and I thought, gosh, if I could just find somebody that I could work with to get these into songs and then present them to people, I really thought, you know, I can make a difference, because music has always made a difference for me. It's been, you know, my savior, my guiding light, you know, all of that throughout my life. So I thought, well, that's what I want to do. And, you know, while singing other people's songs is great, it's not never going to get me to where I wanted to be, which was somebody who was a mouthpiece for other people, sharing my experiences that hopefully they could learn from, grow from, or at least, you know, identify with and maybe help somebody. So I thought, well, I have to do something with it, or I have to shut up about it. Stop talking about it and do it, or just shut up, because I kept saying, oh God, I want this so bad, but I wasn't doing anything to get it. And as I say, I grew a pair, and I looked and I still think back to, and I can't believe that I called, but thank God, you know, when you're sometimes when you're really young, you're able to do things that you think when you're older, man, I don't know that I would do that. That took a lot of, you know, gravitas to do that. But I think I just got tired of hearing myself talk about it.
All right. Yeah. So as you said, you finally kind of grew a set and jumped into chasing after creating your own music. Now, Bruce.
Yes.
You're on stage right now. Playing all these instruments at one time. I kind of had the vision in my head. I had one of two things going on. You've already stated that you play everything live. So either I thought there was a backing track. Actually, I take that back. One of three things. A backing track, a backing band that you guys hired to play live. Or have you ever gone into the bar and seen the one-man band who has like the accordion, the drum, and the harmonica all going at the same time? I was envisioning a rock version of that. How do you get the sound that you get?
It's not like any of that. So I have this drum / sampler, basically, that's a Roland Hand Sonic. It's called a HPD-20. And it has drum sounds in it that I can play like a drum kit, bass drum, snare drum, hi-hat, toms and stuff. But also samples, I'll hear an interesting sound. I'll be like, oh, I want to sample that sound. Or I'll hear a line in a movie and I'll be like, oh, I want to capture that and put it in my sampler, basically, that I can trigger these things.
I have to stop you for a minute because it's kind of funny because things that we have sampled, bowls.
Yeah, bowls from our kitchen.
Bowls from our kitchen, water bottles, washing machine. There is no bounds to what he will sample.
But it mostly sounds like a drum kit. You know, it sounds like a rock drum kit with all these other colors in it. And I have a pedal hooked up to that so I can play additional sounds with my feet while the song's going on, which will be bass notes or chords sometimes to beef up the sound. The guitar plays through a Roland pedal, which is a GT100. It's like, you know, I use that for my guitar amp. I program on all the guitar sounds to be able to switch and make different sounds of the guitar, including synth sounds and bass sounds and all that stuff. And it all plays into a looping station, which is Boss RC 50, I think that's correct. Mm-hmm. Okay. Let me play three independent loops, either independent or together. I can turn off this loop, turn on that loop, build it all up live. The song gets built up live, you know, while it's playing. So that's the basic equipment that I'm using live.
But then we have to talk about what really changed our sound a while ago. We went from being a rock band to a harder, heavier rock band because of PRS guitars.
Yeah.
Which we have two. Yeah, okay. And those are, he plays those on stage as well.
How did the PRS guitars change your sound from to heavier?
Well, I was using a Guild Bluesbird, which has a really sweet, pretty tone to it, and even really overdriven, it was just
clean,
very clean and polite. It was a very polite sound, you know, and a lot a low end to it, and it was just kind of pretty all the time.
It was so pretty.
And I loved that guitar, but it was not making us sound as aggressive as we wanted to. I got a relatively cheap guitar on, I think, eBay, that was the Tremonti SE or version of it, and it just had this very aggressive sound to it. And as soon as we started to use that, the songs all got more and more just cutting edge, heavy, aggressive. The arrangements got more aggressive. So it was just the tone of that guitar and the sound of it. I was like, well, now I just love, you know, PRS, Paul Reed Smith guitars. So then I got another one. We're chasing that sound.
Yeah, sadly, I think that Guild kind of held us back a little bit because it made us polite. You know, once he started playing with the Tremonti, then all of a sudden it unleashed the beast, you know, and we could be what I think that we always meant to be. And it's just amazing how a guitar can really either open you up or kind of keep you maybe, you know, in a little box that you didn't know you were in, but it just broke open our sound.
Yeah, it is amazing how guitar tone can just completely change. It sounds a little obvious, but the sound of a band.
Yeah.
And the attitude that they have. and all the greatest bands, at least in my mind, have guitarists that have an identifiable tone. Like, say, you have Dimebag Darrell from Pantera. You know that guitar tone once you hear it. Kerry King from Slayer. You know.
Even The Edge. Like, U2's The Edge.
Yeah.
You know, you when you hear that guitar, you say, oh, that's U2. You know, even without Bono singing, you know it's a U2 song. So I think it has changed it to that way. Hopefully we'll be that recognizable someday soon. We're working toward it. But it's really amazing. The equipment that you use is as important as, I think, the skills that the people performing have. And Bruce is really, he's kind of a mad scientist up there. If you watch him, he's fully going left to right all the time because he's pushing pedals, pushing pedals, starting, you know, creating drum loops, you know, and then creating a drum loop on a drum loop. It's really amazing thing to see. And you just keep waiting to see where the sound's coming from. And it's this one guy. I think it's really neat when you see us live because it's, I think, unlike anything that people have seen live.
Yeah, it's got to be cool seeing somebody in front of you build a song as you go along playing different layers.
Exactly.
So we've talked about your sound. Let's talk about your image a little bit. You kind of have this steampunk gothic vibe that you put off. Am I correct in saying so?
We always say we are what you want us to be. We're open to that. We do like the steampunk. We like that kind of old is new thing, that kind of machine versus organic. And that's kind of really, I think, at the heart of the band, because Bruce came up with the name Ascent a long time ago. And really what it's grown to be is our logo is a crow that is part mechanical and part organic, because we feel like that's what we are, is we're part mechanical, which is Bruce, and part organic, which really is me.
Okay.
So that kind of, I think, feeds into that steampunk, old is new. You know, you can be, you know, you can kind of make amazing things from nothing or make amazing things from pieces, which is kind of, if you think about it, what Bruce does is he makes these amazing sounds from these pieces. So it's definitely dark because our sound has gotten darker. And it was something, ironically, that I kind of dressed us for promotional pictures years ago. And we went, that's our look. Like, I dressed as like steampunk just to be cool in pictures. And I was like, we should do that.
I think the steampunk thing has a lot of, you know, the machinery and the complexity, the gears that I can't figure out how this machine is supposed to work. You know, all that kind of stuff to me, it relates directly to what we're going for in the music. You know, the music is kind of ornate. It has a lot of stuff going on. I think the steampunk really fits in well with that. And we want to stand out. You know, when we play, we want you to see us and go, okay, well, what the hell is that going to be? Who are these people? Who do they think we are? They are, you know, and the band, I think the we have plays into that too.
And there is a darkness to our music. We definitely, there's a lot of dark themes in our music, and it's just, it's what we see, you know, what we experience through people that we care about or people that we know or even strangers, and then our experience. And some of them, you know, are difficult. So a lot of our music or themes are dark. So that's where that dark part and that crow comes in, because a crow is this very dark figure that mostly people see as nuisance or a bother. And we think crows are beautiful and amazingly smart and really brilliant. So there's something to be said about maybe looking at something and saying, oh, I discount that, and then really finding out how amazing and beautiful and magical it is. I think we've kind of found our niche in what we like. Lots of eye makeup. Dark clothing, you know, the steampunk look and feel, and with a little bit of goth, because there's that Victorian part of steampunk too that I really like.
And for some reason with the crow and the gothic aspect of it, it kind of has a bubonic plague feel to it, like the quack, the witch doctors.
I love that. And it becomes and is whatever you need it to be. I feel like that's what music is, and that's what we want to be, is whatever it is that you want it to be, need it to be, or imagine it to be. That's what music is.
Are you saying that I need the bubonic plague?
Explore the darker side of things. Maybe there's a dark side in there that needs a little nurturing. I'm not sure.
All right, so you kind of take from the darker side of steampunk and style and Are there any bands out there right now that are currently inspiring you?
Oh yeah. I mean, I don't know that they're current bands. We have a lot of references that we take from some of Bruce's. I don't want to talk for you, but I think of Genesis, you know, think of Peter Gabriel's role. There was a darkness, but then also I can laugh at myself and whimsy, but then the stage performance was everything. And there was a costume aspect of it, but it was his identity as well. And so there's something there, I think, that we really take from and that we're really inspired by. I think for me, I was very into a lot of, you know, I was into The Cure. I was into Susie and the Banshees. I was into a lot of that music. I mean, honestly, I was into everything. But I'd say some of those, if you think about the look and the kind of the way they branded themselves was very specific. There was no doubt that, you know, what genre they were, what they were going for. And there's something really powerful about that. I mean, think of Robert Smith's hair. I mean, I think of his hair and his makeup today, you know, and you say, oh, well, that's Robert Smith. You don't even have to see his face. You just see him from behind. That's Robert Smith. Look at that hair. You know, there's just something about that image that really spoke to me then, and the stage presence as well. I mean, from a purely theatrical point of view. But then musically, I think then we go, Bruce and I go kind of in different directions on our musical influences. Sadly, there aren't very many that are current, although I will say Muse is one of our favorite bands right now.
They're interesting.
Yeah, we're very into Muse. Muse is a very powerful band. We also like Stephen Wilson. Stephen Wilson he used to be in Porcupine Tree.
Yeah. Porcupine Tree was definitely prog rock and got into heavy, you know, a heavier side of prog rock later on in their career. And I think, you know, we definitely summon some of that with our music. You know, we like, I grew up on all that prog stuff, like right. King Crimson and Yes and all that stuff. And I grew up with just on pure metal, like Black Sabbath.
Okay.
There's some of that that's in there. There's some of the pop stuff and some of the punk stuff. You know, some of what Christina was saying before about we are what you want us to be. I think we say that because people want to categorize, you know.
They do.
What do you sound like? Who do you sound like? What's your music? We, whatever they say it is, that's what we are. We don't change what we do, but, oh, you're goth. Okay. Cool, we're goth. You're metal. Cool,
okay.
We're metal. You're punk.
You know,
that's great. Whatever you say, we're going to do what we do. If you want to interpret it through that lens because you like that and that makes sense to you, absolutely.
Going back to your question, I think A Perfect Circle is a big one for us too, for sure. They're a huge influence on us. I will say growing up, my musical influences were a lot more in the pop range, you know, so I grew up with a lot more pop and really liking pop and liking that relatability, that accessibility. So I think that's really one of the things I bring to the band is to try to always keep it as accessible as possible because prog can go really crazy. I think I kind of keep us in that realm and Bruce keeps us kind of edgy because when Beacon 11 is the song you played at the beginning of the show and that song's in 11.
What do you mean by it's in 11?
So it's not in 4/4, it's in 11/8. So it's based on a riff that has 11 beats in it. And so we've done a few different things like that. We have a song like one of our big live moments, The Abduction of Jane Doe, is a song in 5. I'm really attracted to those odd meters, you know, but I think the important thing with doing an odd meter, and I think Beacon 11 definitely attests to that, is that I think we make it sound more straightforward than it really is.
Right.
I think we make it groove. I think we make it you know, something that you can listen to and you're not like, well, that's just, you're just trying to be clever. You
right.
know, it's more, it needs to stand on its own and actually work. But yeah, we do a lot of stuff that falls in that kind of progressive world, especially with the timing and the chord progressions and stuff.
Okay. So you get a little bit into the math rock.
Yeah.
Like that. So, all right. So, I at first when you said 11, I was thinking it could be like a Spinal Tap reference. Like, can we really crank that one up to 11 there?
Do that. See, it's anything you want it to be.
It's whatever you want it to be.
Of course. And you just don't want to be the drummer for Spinal Tap. I'll tell you.
No.
No, but we will bring a henge on stage.
Yeah,
we will. We're not above a little henge. We're not.
No.
I don't know how to transition from that, so I'll just jump over. I'll just jump over this and be like, "You guys are working on new music, right?"
Oh yeah, our little tiny henge we're jumping over is into new music. We are trying really hard to create our latest album, but we're releasing it as singles because we're not going to make anyone wait. And to be honest, we can't wait. We're excited to get the music out there. So we've released, I think, 5 songs so far off of our new album. We're hoping to get it done, but we just keep writing more songs. We debuted 2 new songs. So we just keep writing. So we're, I think once we get to 10, we're going to call it done with an album, I think.
Yeah, maybe print some up, maybe, but mostly, you know, people want to consume the music online. So we're, you know, we're recording songs and we're making videos, mostly sort of lyric videos.
Lyric videos, because it's about the lyrics are really important. They tell the stories. So yeah, we are definitely working on a lot of new music and we're releasing it slowly. And as soon as it's done, we release it and then share it with the masses everywhere and in any way we can. I mean, not only social media, but I'll send texts. I have no shame. I will call people and remind them. I'll tag them in everything. I'm like, no, you need to listen to this. Tell me what you think.
And if you listen to us on Spotify, we get paid. So,
Nice.
So yeah, working on a lot of new music. Our last album was a few years ago. So it's been a work in progress, but we are getting it done right now so that we can get it out. So yeah, we're really excited about our new music. I'm very excited about it. And there's a lot more where that came from.
Okay, cool. So you're releasing new songs online about how often?
I'd say probably once a month right now.
Yeah, about one song a month.
Okay, and the videos at about the same time, or?
It's not really super regular, but.
Yeah, I'd say probably within 4 to 6 weeks, we're releasing a lot more. And it's not because the song isn't ready. It's because we have to become comfortable with it enough to want to record it, which means we've got to practice it a lot and play it a lot live, because then that shapes how we record it. We want to let it kind of breathe and then record it. So that's why there's a staggered approach to it, because Bruce produces, mixes, and masters everything. We just need to let it breathe a little so that it sounds like us, you know, and it doesn't sound like it just came out of the box, you know. We just opened the box and gave it to you, and we let it breathe a little bit, and we massaged it a little.
We're both control freaks, so we will continue to mess around with the recording and the mix forever, just endlessly. And that's part of the joy of actually releasing it, putting it up on YouTube or putting it wherever, is that once we put it out there, it's done.
It's done.
Yeah, you know, I don't know who made the quote like that. Piece of art is never done. You just need to know when to walk away or be able to give up on it.
Yep.
Oh, that is true.
I totally messed that saying up. It's something along those lines, though.
Yeah, literally spend the rest of our lives working on any one song that we have. We could. See, we just have to stop and walk away.
We will go insane.
We will go crazy. So we just stop, put it out there to the world. And I'm not going to say that we don't ever go back and re-record stuff. Because we will, because we're crazy like that. And then we'll re-release it, because we're like, that was stupid. No, listen to this version.
The remastered version, man.
Yeah, exactly.
What you're doing is, like, I find that to be really common now, too. Instead of dropping that one album every 2 years or whatever, people releasing songs, like, steady throughout. One, because you mentioned a lot of people aren't buying albums. But 2, because I think that it helps keep you relevant in people's ears. If you release one CD, you know, it has a certain lifespan. If you release a track now, a track later, spread that CD out over 2 years, and then you stay in their ears for that whole time.
It's cool because every new song that you put out, it can be an event. Each song is important in its own right. Whereas, you know, if you had a record and, you know, the third song on side 2 doesn't get the fanfare, you know what I mean? We push out every song with a lot of fanfare and make a big fuss about it. And I think that's part of what we gain from doing it this way.
Well, and I think the other thing that's really cool, I mean, there's a lot of downsides, obviously, about where music is gone from an industry perspective. But then there are a lot of upsides. And one is it challenges, I think, us as artists to not really have a, quote, B-side. Or a bad song. Every song needs to be solid and accessible and playable and something that people want to hear, because there's no fillers anymore. You know, it's they're listening to each song, you know, as you release it. Each song stands on its own. They can either buy it or not buy it. That really, I think, pushes you as an artist to do more and better and stretch yourself. So for me, I think it makes us write better songs than, you know, if we were, I'd say if we were making music, you know, 40 years ago, we could be like, well, we'll do four really good ones and then we'll put like six kind of good ones, whatever we got, we'll throw it on there. But those four will sell it, you know? So it kind of changes the game in that one. I think it makes us all up our game.
That's a really good point. It's like now everything has to be a quote unquote radio single.
Yes, yeah. It's so true. So I think that's great, but it also, you know, it's hard for a lot of artists, and it's also takes time to create music that's, you know, not disposable, or, you know, obviously going way back, not a B-side or not one of the six that's just, you know, the throwaway tracks on an album, you know, because those four will sell it. It's just a different game now.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. So how long have you guys been playing together as a band? Or as the two of you, we'll do that. I don't want to make you go back to the age where we said we wouldn't talk about where you discovered the steampunk look and all that. But how long have you two been together as a band?
It's been 20 years.
As a two-piece?
20 years as a two-piece. Yeah. We were only in the big five-piece band for, I'd say, about... it was probably like 4 months. Then we were a three piece for probably another 6 months. But we were always doing stuff on the side as a duo. We were doing acoustic music when we were doing the rock music with the big band. So we've always been, I'd say, since probably week four or five, we've been a duo as well.
But I like to say this version of us is sort of more heavy rock version of us. It's not that old.
It's not.
It's what, three, 4 years?
3 or 4 years old.
That we've been kind of promoting ourselves this way and having the identity that we currently have. So
right.
In that sense, it's not we're just doing the same thing that we always did. We've changed a lot.
A lot. And people who have been our fans, friends, and family obviously are like, wow, you've come really far from being an acoustic duo. Indeed we have.
But that's good. You need to evolve, you know. You can't sit there and be the same band for the whole time you're together, unless you're AC/DC. Then you can pull it off. But and that wasn't a knock on AC/DC by any means. But
no, they're amazing, and they're making more money than I am. I'll tell you that right now.
But in your experience as a band, like, what would be some advice that you have that you can pass on to people who are looking to get involved in the music industry?
I think you have to be fearless. You just have to go for it, and you have to not apologize for the music you make and the sound that you have and the persona that you are on stage. You just have to go and say, this is me, take it or leave it. I hope you like it. If you don't, that's cool. My music isn't for everyone. And maybe it's not for you. But you have to go and you have to do what you love. And I think that you have to be fearless. Because if we thought for a second about all the stuff we did, we'd probably be like, oh, no, probably shouldn't. You know what? No, that's a little risky. No, what are people going to think? You just have to not care and go out there and hope that people love the art that you're putting out there the way that you do.
Don't chase trends. Don't try to do something that's just going to be easy. You know, you have to challenge yourself. You have to push yourself. People can hear it when you're pushing yourself right to the edge of your ability, you know, right to the edge of what you're comfortable with. And, you know, people respond to that. They hear that. They like that. I think trying to play it safe, trying to say, oh, well, this type of band is popular this year. We're going to do that. That's just going to fail, and that sucks.
And it's never going to be authentic. And authenticity is what I think sells the music and what makes people respond to it. And if you're not authentic, then I don't know that you're ever going to be happy with your music, even if you're successful. We did it the way that we wanted to do it. And we did it in a way that felt good and that represented us. And I can be proud of that. But if I went back and I looked at it and it wasn't us and we did what we needed to do to make money, I think you could see that and feel it on stage, and that's not who we want to be. And hopefully that's not who future artists want to be. One of the things that I think is really cool is, you know, I'm very open to all genres of music, and I can go into a bar or a club and listen to music and I cannot like that kind of music, but man, is that band killing it. for what they're doing. And I just tell them that was amazing because they're doing them. That's what they want to do. It's amazing music. It may not be my thing, but all of a sudden this new level of respect, and I feel the passion, and you see and hear all the heart, and they just leave it on the stage. And that is a good band.
Right on. That all is like excellent advice. You had like four different things in there. Like that. No, that's awesome. The more advice, the better.
That's right. Well, and the other thing that I have to say, I'd be remiss if I didn't, is it is so important to be humble, to maintain your humility. It doesn't matter how big you get, doesn't matter how good you are, doesn't matter how many people tell you you're the most amazing thing they've seen. Be humble, be kind. You know, we're all chasing a dream out there, and there's no reason not to be kind and civil to each other as other bands, but then other people. I mean, it's to us, I mean, you know, if I had to say our band had some core values, that would be one of them, is the humility. We want to always be grateful that people listen to our music. No one has to, you know, and grateful that people like you want to talk to us because you don't have to. So that's something that I think maybe the music scene is also missing too, is there's a lot of egos and not enough appreciation for the fact that people are listening.
Yeah, so you still talk to the little people?
There are no little people. We are the little people.
That's great advice as well. That's great advice as well. So we talked a little bit about promotion earlier as far as releasing tracks every so often instead of one album, or even texting people, hey, I got music out, listen to it. I'm blowing up your phone, your Facebook, your Twitter, and all of that until you listen to it. But what are some other things that you do to promote your band?
Well, I think one of the things that we've been trying to do lately is really talking to other bands and listening to their music and asking them to listen to our music and then sharing their music. And then they share our music. Then we play shows together and we start to build these fan bases that are mixed and that are introduced to different kinds of music than maybe they wouldn't have heard. So we're really trying to connect with other bands that we like, maybe not necessarily that are like us or sound just like us, but other bands that, you know, have that commitment, that are, you know, high quality, whatever we're looking for that day, or whatever catches us, great lyrics, great vocals, great music. And we'll try to see if we can book a show with them and start to share their music and share them with our fans, and they do the same. And then we have those shows, and that's really a huge way to promote your music, is through other bands, because we all have some fan base. And that's a huge new trend for us anyway. I don't know if other people are doing that as much, but that's a lot more work. But really going on Reverb Nation, listening to other people, and then reaching out to them and saying, hey, I heard such and such track today, and I loved it. I'm not trying to sell you anything. I don't want anything. I just want to tell you it was great. You know, I loved this and this and this. And that is the most powerful way to get into any artist's heart, is to say, I listened to your stuff and I loved it.
Definitely.
So that's something that we do a lot of, is listen to other people's music. In fact, we're listening to, we went to LA recently back and forth because we went and saw a concert, and we were listening to the Local Music Experience, which is local musicians, and it's a radio station. We listened to it all the way up and all the way back, and we made a list of the artists we want to reach out to and try to play shows with them. And so we're listening to internet radio, which is helping artists too. You know, those kinds of things are what we do and what we hope other people will do. So that's another way we're promoting it, is really kind of on the back end, maybe not as overt, but on the back end. And we also, of course, do the running ads on Facebook, and we run ads on Instagram and stuff like that if we really want to have somebody listen to a new track. Or if we're like, hey, no one's liked our page in a while, why not? Then we run an ad to try to get people to come listen to us. So we don't really spare much expense. We'll do whatever it takes to get heard. But yeah, we also apply to a bunch of internet radio stations. We are played on the Local Music Experience and stuff like that. So we do that as well, because it's important to be played with other artists. And there's also other music stations that will play new music along with well-known artists that they think you compliment. So that's also a really great way to get your music heard. Although that does usually cost a little bit, it's really not very expensive, and it's a huge win.
So you pay a radio station, or like an internet radio station to...
No, it's not. There's like, God, what was the name of that? It's not a radio station. It's kind of like a... God, I wish I remembered the name of it. But what it is you bought like 100 plays. Let's say you buy 100 plays and it'd be like $10 for 100 plays. They'd add you to a playlist of artists in the middle of artists that they think that, you know, other people might say, oh, I like this artist, so I would like a cent. So they'll play you along with them and you just pay to be included on these playlists of all these other artists. So maybe they'd have us with, let's say, Radiohead, and maybe they'd have us with, you know, Old Genesis, and then all of a sudden they'll have an Ascent track, and then they'll have Muse, you know, whatever it is, and they think, oh, well, people will like it, and then they can that offers it for them to go download your track. So it was a really great way to introduce people, kind of sneak it in there.
Okay, is this like on Pandora then, or?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's what it is. I could not remember what it was. Yeah, I think it was Pandora or the other one that is not as relevant as it used to be anymore. Oh, iHeartRadio. It's not as relevant as Pandora for whatever reason, but I like iHeartRadio. But we used to, that's what we would do, and they would slip your song in there. But then you don't always have to pay them. This was a really old service that we used to pay. I don't think we've never paid Pandora or iHeartRadio.
She's just trying to get out of saying we blow up your social media.
We that's do.
No, it's interesting because I hadn't heard that. So that's a new way to.
When we put stuff out there, when we promote songs online, people love us in India. We have a huge fan base in India. We're trying to figure out why.
Love them.
We're trying to figure out how to get to India.
Yeah, we want to go to India.
They love us in India. So, you know, you never know who it's going to connect with.
Interesting. Yeah, that's crazy. So India specifically loves Ascent.
They love our music.
It's crazy because whenever we run an ad, we'll just run it like worldwide. And it's just India is just like, yes, they're totally in. Yeah. And we're like, right on. So then, obviously, when we run ads, we're like, hey, we're going to definitely include India as a top one. You know, we're like, U.S., sure, but India, for sure, put them in there. I just break it up to, you know, that country, that area, fantastic taste in music.
Yes.
It must be. All right, so besides having a huge fan base in India, what is, like, a highlight or two that you guys would like to share with the Uncontained audience?
Well, I would say that it was probably, we had a Northwest tour that we did in 2016 that was pretty darn epic. We went up through Northern California, Oregon, and then up to Washington and back down and played several shows. I mean, just great places for music. Oregon and Seattle are just obviously amazing. And just the response and it's kind of the shock and awe that you get because they've not seen anything quite like us. But then strangely, we also got this, just, you know, conversely, we also got the, you guys need a bass player. You know, sometimes you get that. Well, on tour, because I think people don't know how to feel about something they've never seen. It always kind of takes them aback. But we got a lot of people who were just really supportive and positive and excited and engaged and gracious. Other bands were amazingly gracious. The venues were gracious. And obviously the people that listened to us were amazingly gracious. So it was a really amazing trip up and back. I mean, we definitely did it on a shoestring budget, but, you know, we rolled up in our SUV, you know. We didn't have like a tour bus or anything. We rolled up in our SUV and stayed in like the Super 8 and rocked that, you know, and one played our shows looking like rock stars and then crawled back into the Super 8 and you know, took a shower and took a nap, you know. But I think that was one of the big highlights.
Yeah, we love going on tour because for a lot of reasons, you know, obviously to make new fans, but it's when you're a band on tour, people treat you differently than if you're a local band. They're like, oh, they roll out the red carpet for you. You know, they do nice stuff for you. They get excited. They pay attention.
They pay you.
Know, you. We love that.
So true.
They pay you.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Which doesn't happen here.
It's like, you gave us money? They're like, oh, yeah, so here's, you know, I was like, oh, drink tickets, that's so nice. Oh, and here's your money. What? I did the shock thing the first time, and I'm like, I just gotta be like, oh, hey, thanks, yeah. So I was like, hey, thanks, and then we go out to the car. Oh, my God, we got paid. That's so cool.
Yeah, but, yeah. I imagine some of that is because in, like, the L.A. area, there's so many bands that are wanting to play and willing to play that they don't need to pay them.
Yeah. It's sad, but it's true. We always say we'll pretty much play wherever you want us to. You want us to come play in your front yard, we'll do that. No problem. Whatever you need.
All right, perfect. I don't have much of a front yard, but...
dining room, patio, whatever you got.
There you go. Play in the living room. That's how we'll do it. All right. When somebody comes to an Ascent show or listens to one of the new tracks you release, what do you want them to take away and feel like and remember about their experience?
Well, I think we want people to come away saying, you know, I haven't heard music like that before. I haven't seen a performance like that before. That wasn't what I expected. I'm surprised, you know, how do those two people do that? You know, that's one side that we want them to be kind of the shock and awe. But we also want people to hear that there's a depth to these songs, that there's meaning to the music, there's meaning to the lyrics, and we want them to walk away saying, I want to listen to that again. I want to listen to that more closely because there's another layer of complexity or meaning or depth to that that I can't take in from just hearing it the one time. You know, that's what we put into our recordings and that's what we put into our live show. We want to grab people's attention and say, listen to this because there's something here that's not what you normally get. That's what I want.
Yeah, and we're not, we have a tagline that I've come up with. It sounds not like it's not humble, but it is, because what I say, our tagline is listen and be changed forever. Because we may not be your style of music, we may not be what you thought, we may not be what you traditionally liked, but once you hear us and see us, it's going to change you. In whatever way it changes you, it may change you in a way that you want to buy our music, may change you in a way that you now listen to different kinds of music. It will change you because it's different. It's not something you see every day or hear every day. And I want people to walk away going, well, that is the most arena-sized bar gig I've ever seen. I want, because we play it, and I know a lot of bands say this, but we play it like we are playing to 50,000 people. There is nothing held back. We dress up every time. We look the part, we play the part. When we get off stage, we are personable. We talk to everyone, we hug everyone, whatever you're into. We're not, you know, I've had people tell us, oh, when you come off stage, you should be the same persona. I'm like, no, when I'm on stage, it's a performance. When I'm off stage, I'm Christina. And this is Bruce. We're just who we are, you know? But I just hope that people say, you know, I saw something today at this bar that I've gone to a million times. It was unlike anything I'd ever seen or heard before. And I'm shocked and I want more.
Yeah, that's awesome when people will like check you out and be like, where can I find out more? Where can I see you? Where can I hear more of you?
I do also hope in my heart of hearts that they also, if they wanted to do it, they go, you know what, I can do it. I've seen these guys do it. They're cool, normal people. I can do it. You know what, I'm going to do it.
She's normal.
Bruce is biting the head off of a bat right now.
Yes. He does that regularly. It's very messy.
Messy, yes.
Messy.
Yeah.
It is expensive. Yeah.
I'm glad to see you laid plastic down. All right. Well, I have one more question for you guys. Okay. All right. Before I get to that question, where can people find you online? What is your corner of the internet? Where can they find these new tracks you're putting out and show dates?
Sure. Well, you can always go to ascent.rocks. So ascent.rocks. That's our official website. But then you can also go to Reverb Nation, and it's Ascent at Reverb Nation. And on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, it's at Ascent Rocks. So it's, the handle is Ascent Rocks on all of those. So we you know, and obviously it's, we're on Spotify, we're on iTunes, we're all those special places. We're even still on CD Baby. Who knew? we're all over the place. So you can really find us anywhere, but you know, if you, you know, I definitely am looking always at, Facebook and Instagram and any messages that come in, as you know, static, any messages that I respond to right away.
You do have a quick response time.
Cause I was like, hey, people want to talk to me. What do they need? What do they want? I'm in, let's do this. So, I mean, it does, you know, anybody who wants to talk to us, share anything about the music or just whatever. You can always reach out to us at Facebook, and I'll definitely, you know, one of us will respond to it as well. So, but our music is always there. Our shows are always there at all those places. So that's where you can find us.
All right, perfect. I'll make sure I put your information in the show notes so they can get a hold of you guys, check out your new songs as they come out. And I have one more question for you. That's the title question of the show. Bruce and Christina Baldwin, how do you live uncontained?
I think that it's all about passion, and it's all about continuing to be fearless and going forward because there's no other choice. We can't not make music, and we can't make music and not share it with the world, because that's why we make music. We make it for us, and then we make it for you. So I don't know that there is a way that even if somebody said, hey, you know, you'll never, quote, make it, whatever that looks like to the individual, I'd say, that's okay. We'll make it in whatever way we can, and we'll continue to do it. And even if we touch one person at every show, we reach one new person every day, we made a difference in somebody's life in some way, it's worth it.
Awesome. Yeah, I think for me, I would say, you know, living uncontained for me is about continuing to try to get better all the time, push my boundaries, push my limits as a guitar player, push my limits as a performer.
Well, you push me.
I push her. The stuff, you know, the stuff that I'm doing on stage now, I would not be able to tell myself that, like, that 5 years ago me, here's what to do, here's how to do it. You know, I couldn't. I probably couldn't tell anybody now how to do it, because it's all just, it's math or something. But, you know, it's like, I think there's so much to be gained by continuing to question, you know, what you're doing, how you're doing it, pushing yourself, learning from others, and continue to try to build up your ability, your technique as a musician. I think we do that together, you know, as we've said, we don't restrict ourselves to any label or genre. We do what we want to do. We do what we feel. And I think we've always done that.
Yes.
And we haven't listened to anybody that said, you need this, you ought to have that, you need a full band, you need a bassist and a drummer to play live, you need, you know, you need to have this kind of song or that kind of sound. We say, screw that. We've always said that. We always stick true to what we do, whether people like it or not.
We appreciate the feedback. We hear you.
We're kind.
We consider it, and we say, yes, we'll put that in, or no, we won't, but we won't give up who we are, and we're never going to be unkind or unappreciative. So I think it's important to be open. I mean, we always say, please give us feedback. So I think it's important. But I think part of receiving that feedback is also knowing when to keep it and hang on to it, and when to say, okay, that's somebody's opinion, we're going to move forward. But I do think, I hear in both of us that it's still about pushing and being fearless, just doing you.
That is a huge piece of advice right there, too, about dealing with feedback. Because feedback is great when you actually get it, especially if it's like, okay, I noticed you're doing this, if you could do this and give a suggestion, that's great. But you also need to know when to follow what you're thinking or what's in your head, what's coming out of you, and differentiate between when to follow and not. But that was a huge point right there. And thank you for making it.
Well, thank you. There's a lot of people who honestly have given us a lot of great ideas and advice. I mean, even up to a couple weeks ago, we had somebody give us a piece of advice that we immediately put into our show. So we do listen, and if it makes sense for us as a band, we take it and we'll run with it, you know, and we will tell that person, you know, because of you, we did this different. But then there's some things where people maybe want to, because it's uncomfortable, put you in a box, and we just won't let them put us in a box. But they can tell us how nice our box is and how we can decorate our box. You know, I'll be like, you know what? If we had a box, we'll decorate it really nice. We're not going to stay in it, but we do have it in case we want to go in. And we'll put a little decoration on there in your honor. But no, we're not going to get in that box.
All right. Fair enough. Okay. I know I said that was the last question, but I just remembered you brought something up at the beginning of the show, or I think it was as we were talking before the show that you wanted to talk about. It had to do with domestic violence.
Yes. Thank you so much. We have a song called Last Night that we released 2 months ago, and It comes from personal experience where I have a friend who is in an abusive relationship still now. And the song was about, it was my discussion with her about what I've heard and what I worry will be her end, which is that she will be mortally hurt by this person. So I wrote the song for her as kind of a, here's what will happen if you don't get out of this relationship. She hates the song, but it stands as a very scary and painful way of saying, hey, you know, this stuff isn't normal. You know, the fact that somebody, you know, hurts you and that you just roll with it isn't normal. And the longer you roll with it, the more likely it is that something is going to happen to you that cannot be reversed. So we have a song called Last Night. That's just a song called Last Night. And the lyric video, we actually have a trigger warning on it because it could be upsetting to some people. But inside, there's actually some lines that are what abusers say to victims. And I actually did research to find out what they say. So those are in the middle, the things that they say to keep you in the abusive relationship. And at the end of the video, there is ways that you can get help. And really the song is, please get help in whatever way you can. It's not okay. It doesn't matter if it happens once, it will happen again. It doesn't matter if it's a slap or a push or anything, that is violence. And just to, you're worth more than that. Get out, get help, and get your life back. That's really what we wanted to say. It's an important message that comes from a friend of mine, their personal experience that hopefully will make a positive impact, you know, on others.
Yeah, I hope it reaches your friend. And also, I hope it reaches others who need that song as well. That's always tough right there.
Yeah.
But now I want to pick the mode back up a little bit.
Sure.
But I thank you guys for coming on the show, talking with me today. I have one final thing for you guys to do, and that is sign off the show. Will you guys do me the honor of signing off the show tonight?
Oh, of course. You've done us the honor. This is Christina.
This is Bruce.
Of Ascent, and we live uncontained.
And that does it for another episode of Uncontained. Thank you for listening, and thank you to Christina and Bruce Baldwin for joining me, talking about their band Ascent. And make sure you check those guys out. Ascent.rocks is their website, and all their other social media is located in the show notes, so make sure you check those out. Tell them you heard them here on Uncontained. Thank you for listening, and until next time, live uncontained.